Well, there's a preview of what we're going to talk about. So first of all, it's a great pleasure to be here. We don't often get to travel to such nice and fascinating places during our work. The title of our presentation today is Building Tall, and as the name suggests, we're going to be talking about tall building design, skyscraper design. And I should say, Carl and myself are both structural engineers. So we typically focus on how to build tall buildings, the technical aspects, all the challenges that engineers deal with. But I think, you know, before we talk about that, the more interesting question, I think, to everyone should be why we build tall, when we should build tall, and then we'll talk a little bit more about the challenges. Moving on from that, we'll look at a few recent buildings that Carl and I have both designed in London and Europe that I think offer some interesting stories that may be of relevance to Malta. And then to conclude, Carl, who grew up here but works with me in London, is going to talk about tall building design in the specific Malta context. So very briefly about myself, I'm a structural engineer. I've worked for 18 years for the same firm, initially in Chicago, and for the last 6 years based in the London office. Carl started out as a structural engineer here in Malta, but has subsequently worked for Foster & Partners in London and for the last 4 years in London with Skidmore, Owings & Merrill. Just briefly, I want to tell you a bit about our firm because the origins of our firm are very tied up in 20th century tall building design. The firm was founded in 1936 by three individuals, one of whom was a structural engineer and two architects. So this idea that architecture and engineering should be one and the same, that idea is very embedded in our firm's ethos. And I think when you do tall buildings, super tall buildings, that idea is inescapable. And I mentioned this, it may seem obvious to some people, but that's not the way I think most designers work today. Our firm has designed many of the tallest buildings in the world, including three of the four towers you see here poking up over the clouds in Chicago. We've won lots of awards, and this lineup changes all the time, but at any given time, we've probably engineered and designed half of the world's tallest buildings, and nearly almost 40 buildings over 300 meters. Unlike other firms that do tall buildings, we only have about 100 engineers worldwide. The other people who do tall buildings probably have thousands. So it's a very concentrated pool of experts who work on tall buildings. And we are both architects and structural engineers. And for every one engineer, there's probably four or five more architects. And our expertise goes back to the 60s when we really did the first generation of modern tall buildings in the US. And looking ahead to the future, where we're currently designing the next generation of optimized tall buildings for the future. So, moving on, I think the first question we're going to talk about is why one should even considering building tall buildings. These are tall buildings. These are 43-story buildings, and for most of human history, these were the tallest structures, man-made structures on Earth. From as far back as we know, people have always had an innate desire to build very tall monuments and build them even when they're incredibly difficult and expensive to build. We don't know quite why the pyramids were built, but clearly the pharaoh wanted to leave something lasting that he would be remembered by, and he certainly succeeded in that. And I would suggest that modern reasons for building tall buildings are not all that dissimilar. Wanting to do something brash and tall that will last beyond you. Of course, there's the biblical parables of the Tower of Babel that are fraught with the ego and ambition and overreaching that sometimes is associated with building tall. But I think more recently, although still a long way in the past, medieval Italy was scattered with very tall towers that competing city-states would often erect to the point where they would collapse. That's why so many are few, but just largely out of symbolic competition. So I think it's fair to say, when we look at tall buildings in the past and now, this desire to just go higher just for that sake or for ego's sake is always there. And it's tied up with the practical reasons that we justify building tall now. And it's always there. So there's an emotional and an irrational side to it, and of course also the practical side. So getting on to more recent times, I think most people consider the home insurance building in Chicago on the left here, that's just 10 stories, the first modern skyscraper or tall building. And that's not necessarily because of its height, but because it's the first building to really use a steel and iron frame. It weighed about a third as much as a building of the time would have otherwise. It was made possible by the elevator, among other things. And then later, and this was at the end of the 19th century, later, I think, in the 30s in the US, the most famous tall buildings in the world are still arguably the Chrysler Building and the Empire State Building. The Empire State Building is 103 stories tall. It's still one of the tallest buildings in the world. But I think what's very interesting about this building is it was built very quickly. It was built at a time when America was, obviously there was money in New York, and America was an emerging power on the world stage. And people had ambitions not only of building office space, but also of building something that really symbolically said, we're here, we're important. Because building a tall building is not the most economic way to build office space in most circumstances. It's more expensive, it's more complicated. And like it or not, architects don't like to admit this, but 99% of what we do is building space that will make a developer money. And this building was no different, but it actually failed on that measure. For 20 years, it was not economically viable. And even today, if you go to this building, the Art Deco lobby is very amazing, but the office space is cramped and horrible and doesn't meet modern standards by any in any way. However, the observation deck makes a tremendous amount of money. So this most iconic tall building arguably was a failure at its stated function. And I would suggest that's because of, its ambitions, outstretched the economic and practical realities. I also want to point out, because I'm a structural engineer, that the structure of this building was what I would call brute force. It was obviously made possible by steel, but it employed just lots of closely spaced columns packed together and didn't really optimize the lateral stability of the building in the way we would today. And so the amount of steel in this building is much, much, much higher than it would be if we were to design a similar sized building today. It's strange, because of the world wars, World War II, it's not really till the late 60s and early 70s that we see what I would call the first generation of modern skyscrapers. The one on the left is the Hancock Building in Chicago, which our firm designed. And believe it or not, when I started working, engineers who worked on this were still in the office. So it's not that far back in time. And then the Sears Tower, which until very recently was the tallest building in the world. Both of these buildings used completely new structural systems, and they used what I'll call modern rational engineering analysis and the computer to really analyze these buildings and consider them holistically and make them much more efficient to build. The Hancock Building used cross bracing, and we call this a brace tube. Obviously, having these big braces on the exterior of the building makes it really stable, it reaches out. And then the Sears Tower we call a bundled tube. Both of these innovations were designed by engineers at Skidmore, Owings & Merrill. But I think what's significant from a design point of view is the Hancock Building would not have been economically viable because of the massive amount of steel it would take to construct it unless a modern engineering approach was taken. And the architects embraced that. They didn't try to hide the bracing. The building has a simple tapering form. It has big X bracing. And that has become the signature motif for this iconic building. And that's what people like and love about it. So engineering and architecture as one to create a practical, and when I say practical, I mean a building that's economically viable and makes return for its owners. So moving on from the Hancock Building and Sears Tower, I guess now it's the Willis Tower, and more recently, and I'll talk about this in more detail, our firm did the world's tallest building, the Burj Khalifa. Starting in the 80s, I think we're seeing a whole new generation of super tall buildings in China, and I think it's no coincidence that the economic and political importance of China is largely behind this. So we obviously have the economic drivers, but also this desire to be seen and to show the world how important we are. The building in the middle was built in the 80s by Skidmore, Owings & Merrill, and it's been subsequently surpassed by, or will be, by the two behind it. So China, more recently, and then of course Dubai, which a few decades ago there was nothing, and now there's arguably way too many tall buildings. And I think there are interesting stories here, because clearly there's some ambition and irrationality going on here, but a lot of these buildings are also profitable because of the unique economy that is Dubai. So I think the irrational sometimes can become tangible and real too. So I have been suggesting that tall buildings are largely about ego and pride, and obviously often making money, but I think it's important that there's also an aspect of novelty and fun too. These are the observation decks on the Sears Tower, and people just love going there for the sheer fun of being that high. Children love it. It's just a playful, there's something playful and exciting about it. But again, that very fact results in real value. The observation decks on these buildings make a fortune, and people pay a premium to have an office up high because it's fun, or an apartment up high because it's fun to have a view. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the Burj Dubai. This is not a talk on the Burj Dubai, but because it's an extreme outlier, it's the tallest building in the world, just a little bit about the story about how and why it was built, I think, is telling. And then some of that story is relevant to smaller buildings as well. So why would you build the world's tallest building in a country where there's essentially nothing? And sorry, I don't want to insult anyone, but there's no lack of space, and there's no need to build a 150-story building. There's no shortage of land. Well, the answer, sorry, I'm skipping ahead. The answer is simple. The king gave the developer 1 square kilometer of land for free, under the condition that what they built there included the world's tallest building. So right there you have the two aspects. You have clearly, I'll say ego, but not in a negative way necessarily, and then the developer still wants to make money on this. So he has this constraint. He has to build this tallest building, but also clearly the developer wants to make money. So there was an international competition, but not a huge competition. The Emaar Properties went out to some of the famous architects throughout the world, including us. And I think it was just over a couple weeks, we got a little bit of money, and we studied lots of ideas. And these are some of the other ones that didn't win. And the way the story is told to me, and I was a young engineer in the office at the time this came in, I didn't fully understand all the big things that were happening around me, but I knew I had to run around very quickly and give people answers and things, and there was a lot of stress. But what happened is we didn't present a final, beautiful rendered design. The client liked the way we worked together, and he became clear that he could work with us to develop a design idea. And the design changed greatly over the first year. The initial scheme was intended to just barely be the world's tallest building. And then over time, it evolved into a much, much taller building, because we all learned together, we learned what was possible, we learned how much it cost to go higher, and the design crept up and up and up over time. So I think the lesson there is when you have a good client who'll work with you, the answers aren't always all there at the beginning, and that's especially true if your ambition is to build as tall as you possibly can. Just a bit about the design, the architectural story, which is true, is there's an inspiration in plan from a desert flower and traditional Islamic forms, and this is all well and true, but there's also a much more practical reason for this three-tiered shape. When you build a tall building, you can't simply scale up a smaller building, just in the same way you can't just scale up animal bones. A building doesn't scale linearly. And what I mean by that is if you took the Sears Tower and you simply made it 50% bigger, the volume would scale exponentially, okay? And, okay, that's fine. You still have the same proportions. But what it means is you have just way, way, way too much volume and area. The floor plates become enormous. They become too big to be usable. People are miles away from the window. And simply, you just have too much built area. You know, already with this building, you have millions of square feet. And it's too much. So, but at the same time, you can't make an incredibly skinny tower or it's going to fall over. You need breadth at the base to make it stable, but at the same time, you need to minimize the floor plates and keep the proportions right. So this three-tiered shape essentially increases the volume, the surface-to-volume ratio, decreases the volume, and decreases the interior dimensions to be reasonable, as you can imagine. You're essentially pinching in a volume to remove volume and add area. But this is geometrically very important to build a tall building. And to a lesser degree, this same issues with volume and scale is very, is also very important for more modest tall buildings. Just briefly, this is a plan, and you can see each one of these wings is the proportion of a typical residential building. Okay, and that's because you need corridors, you need lifts, and you don't want an apartment that's 20 meters deep. It just doesn't work. So the same basic spatial layouts for different sorts of use have to work even on this building that's so much taller. One thing I'm not going to talk about today, just for time, is the lifting strategy and the elevators. But I'll suffice it to say that that's one of the most complicated aspects about this tall building. The taller you go, more and more of your building gets taken up in all the services to get up and down. And that costs money because you're using up area that would otherwise be sellable. And that's a huge technical challenge in and of itself. I'll finish talking about the Burj by just saying the building keeps setting back and getting narrower, so it maintains the same aspect ratio, as I would call it. That's the ratio of the height above to the width for stability reasons. And each wing sets back incrementally in a spiraling shape. So I think clearly building the world's tallest building, it serves the emotional desire, the symbolic prestige, the novelty. It's an icon and it's a landmark structure. But what's interesting about the Burj is it's tempting to assume that it was funded by a sovereign as a symbol, which is what I assume is happening right now in Saudi Arabia with the kilometer tall building. But the truth is I don't really know the financing behind it. But this is an interesting story because this building made money. And it made money because it attracted people to the area. It's become the centerpiece of a much wider development. All the buildings near it sell for more money because they're part of this prestigious complex. And frankly, the unique circumstances of Dubai make it valuable for people to have offices here. A lot of people doing business in the Middle East, they don't want to or can't go to Saudi Arabia to do a deal. But they're comfortable meeting in Dubai, making a deal. And it's become an international center of, deals and commerce, and people pay to have space in this building. It's rather depressing when you realize that 50 designers worked for like 7 years on this, and the cost of like one apartment is like our fee for all of that time. But such are the realities of being a designer in the world. So that's the world's tallest building. Now I want to talk just about some engineering, because we're structural engineers after all. And I know a lot of you are probably designers, so some of this is technical, but I think it's try to make it interesting. When building a tall building, I'll say a building that's over 40 stories or so, the predominant structural engineering issue is often wind, unless we're in a high seismic zone. And we tend to think of wind as this static force that blows and pushes over a building, and then you take it off, and the building comes back. At least that's how engineers think about it, wrongly often. But the reality is the wind is a dynamic, turbulent phenomenon. And when wind passes by a tall building, it creates vortices that create pockets of suction on either side of the building, and those alternate, and they move, and they push the building side to side. And this is a computational fluid dynamics model of a steady flow of wind passing by a building. And on the left, you see an actual photograph of the clouds in compensation sort of capturing these vortex shedding in a tall building. We often say if a tall building were to fall over in the wind, it would fall over sideways to the way the wind is blowing. The wind tends to shake a building side by side. And this is a little wind tunnel an engineer who used to work in my company made at home with his children for his science, their science project. I suspect the teachers realized that father helped them out. And a simple foam extrusion subjected to a wind starts to shake violently side to side. So the wind is behaving in ways that are far more complicated than I, as a structural engineer, can fully, well, I can comprehend it, but I can't fully analyze it. And not only that, but the building itself and the way it moves in response to the wind are important. Harmonic resonance in particular, and what I mean by that is the natural modes of vibration that a building moves at. When you kick your feet on a swing, each time you kick it, you naturally just kick your feet at just the right time to keep adding to the frequency at which the swing is swinging. In the same way, a building, if it interacts with the wind and it tends to vibrate at the same or similar modes of vibration that the wind is acting, you can get big resonance effect. So we actually have to tune buildings the way you tune a guitar swing. By making them stiffer, they vibrate at a higher frequency. By making them heavier, they vibrate at a lower frequency. And all of this can be beneficial or detrimental in the way it interacts with the wind. So we usually can't see tall buildings move, but these tall, skinny poles are basically just like tall buildings, okay? They're cantilevers sticking out of the ground. It just happens that these poles are slender enough that you can actually see them moving. But this is what happens when the wind blows in a tall building. And you probably can never see this, but if you're living in a building and you've paid £1 million for the 80th floor apartment in the building, you're not happy when your building moves. And so these two videos here were taken through some tests that a wind tunnel commissioned to study human perception. They both represent 30 millig's, that's 30,000th the acceleration of gravity. And one is for a lower frequency, and one is for a higher frequency. Depending on the frequency of the building, the way you perceive these can be very different. And this is very important because, believe it or not, most of our tall buildings, the thing we design for is limiting this to perceptible limits. So it's not how strong the building is. It's plenty strong. It actually comes down to not annoying or scaring the occupants near the top of the building. And those criteria are more stringent for residential because people get nervous, it's their own house, they paid for it, and more lax for office because people tend to care less. So a very subjective criteria is often controlling the design of tall buildings. So in order to study this, we go into the wind tunnel, we build expensive models and we measure, we test them just like aircraft and Formula One cars. This is a workshop a few years ago that Carl and myself attended for a tall building in Gothenburg. We spent a day, and our building didn't work. It was moving too much. So we turned it 45 degrees, and it just barely worked. And not only do we tune the structural characteristics of the building, but we also tune the architecture. You'll see these spirals on smokestacks sometime, and what they do is they confuse the wood with the wind, they break up the vortex shedding, and they allow the building not to smokestack to vibrate. The architectural form of Burj Dubai was tweaked many, many times in order to minimize the wind loads in the same way we put these spiraling forms sometimes on skyscrapers. So architecture and engineering, one and the same, working together to make the building efficient and buildable. This is just sort of an illustration of how that happens. The vortices at different levels come off at different frequencies, and the wind never ends up being organized enough to really shake the building. Finally, I think not only do tall buildings affect themselves, but they can also be so heavy that they affect the ground. This is a model of the ground around the Burj Dubai, and it displaces and moves a huge amount of earth. It's a huge load coming down on the earth, and you sometimes have to be careful that you don't adversely affect your neighbors. By putting a tall building up in Malta, for instance, you might crack and damage buildings that are a block away. And so this needs to be considered carefully. This was a pile test, the world's largest pile test for Burj Dubai. And finally, construction. These buildings are so complicated and expensive and use so much materials. If you can't build them easily, they're economically unviable. You have to be able to do this quickly. If a building takes 20 years to build, it's just economically infeasible now. So quickly wrapping up, some recent buildings that are smaller that Carl and I have worked on. This is an 80-story tall tower in Gothenburg. It'll be the tallest building in Scandinavia. It's under construction right now. And every tall building, I think, has its own challenges that add to the cost and complexity that's far beyond what you'd have in a more modestly sized building. This building was incredibly difficult foundations. There wasn't bedrock for 80 meters, so we had to pile 80 meters down. And to make this skinny building stable, we had to add these large outrigger structures that reach out and stabilize the building. And these are very complex structures that probably take several months to build each and cost, you know, several million dollars each. A recent building we won planning approval for in London is 57 stories tall. And this building was challenging because in London there's these view corridors, and the building shape has to get out of the way of certain views, and so it has this complicated slanted geometry which makes reconciling the steel bracing quite challenging. A different problem, but another tall building challenge. We looked at many, many different options to pick the most efficient, but at the end of the day, the aesthetics of a bracing pattern that weren't as efficient actually are probably what's going to get built. So there's compromise from a purely engineering point. And before I hand over to Carl, I want to talk about a building I've worked on for the last 5 years in London. It's 42 stories tall. It's all residential. And my thought is buildings in Malta, tall buildings, will probably be of a similar scale. This building is notable because architecturally, we decided to take out a huge notch from the building in two places. The developer wanted to do something dramatic architecturally, and he was willing to pay for the incredible engineering effort it took to do this. So this is an engineering problem we created for ourselves and then took pleasure in solving. I tend to think tall buildings are complicated enough just by virtue of being tall. But again, I think because there's so much emotional and aspirational aspects of tall building design, it's inevitable that designs will come out that aren't necessarily practical and efficient and do grand architectural gestures that are very difficult and add cost. So this is a perfect example of that. We had to, all of this structure you see is just to allow taking out all those columns and create that architectural drama there. We think this probably added 5 or 10 million pounds to the cost of the building. And I think it's interesting that the tall building proposed in Malta is doing similar, rather dramatic architectural gestures here. So that, I guess, I'm going to hand over to Carl now, and he's going to talk about tall buildings in the specific context of Malta.
Hello, everybody. Leila Taiba, actually. So I'm going to talk a bit about something closer to home. I'm going to talk about tall buildings in Malta. And I'm not going to go into any specific project, including the one from this morning. I'm just going to try to look at these five main questions, or basically I'm not going to answer any of them, okay? I'm just going to give you more questions, but I'm just going to give some ideas of how I would answer these questions. So these questions would be, do we need tall buildings in Malta? And if so, what are their benefits? And if we're going to put them, where to put them, how to design them, and finally, how to build them. And I'll just share some of my thoughts about this topic. So the first question, do we need tall buildings in Malta? Okay, I think we all know Malta is very small. The population density is very high. The population is actually increasing. So this brings about a demand, okay, for habitable space, whether it's domestic or workplace, doesn't matter. There is an increase in the demand. And we also know that Malta is very dense. Okay, it finds the urban fabric of Malta finds its origin from the medieval times, essentially, where all the buildings were developed either within defensive walls, such as Senglé or Valletta, indeed, where we are here, or like in my hometown, Zeytun, centered around the village church or the town church. Okay, so everything grew organically around the village church. It was a very ad hoc process, I would say, but it worked. Okay. So urbanism really in Malta has been very ad hoc, okay, with the sort of process we're talking about, except for Valletta, which was actually planned and was built according to a specific plan. And you could say also Santa Lucia a bit more recently. But besides that, we all know we have very limited space, we have very limited open space. So I think the answer to the first question is probably we do need tall buildings in Malta. Okay, so what are their benefits? We have seen a few tall buildings in Malta, and I'm going to use Porto Mazo because it would be, in my mind, the case study to refer to, okay, time and time again tonight. And I would say this was Malta's first tall building. So what were the benefits of Porto Mazo? Okay, there were a few benefits. There was the creation of open space, okay, there was the creation of the marina itself, which created completely new open space to the public. There were obviously the tower itself, which was a unique structure. It had a unique selling point, the views. It was basically a proper office block, which in Malta was rather unavailable at the time. And there was obviously the property value, so there was an obvious benefit there. And I think it was a success story. You would say that this was a success story. So benefits do exist for tall buildings. But I would say that some people would say, what is the public getting from these tall buildings, okay? So I think the benefit, besides to the developer, should be also to the public in general. So I will take some case studies from the UK, okay, from London. So there are two tall buildings in London, and most tall buildings in London would require to have a public open space at the top, okay, just to give something back to society. So the walkie-talkie here on the left, which is actually 20 Fenchurch Street, but we call it walkie-talkie, has this open garden at the top. Okay, it's free, it's accessible, everyone can go. You just need to book in advance for security reasons. But it's a proper public space. Okay, and people go there and enjoy having a coffee, walk around the garden, which is 40 floors up in the air, so it's also exciting. Compared to the Shard, which is the tallest building in London, there is also a public open space, but you have to pay 30 quid to get there. Okay, so public, in my view, should be free. Porto Mazo has somewhere in between. It's a semi-public, semi-private bar at the top, okay? But again, there is something which the public is getting back. So when we think of the benefits, we have to think for everyone's benefits, okay? Not just the developer or the occupants of the building. So if we have tall buildings in Malta, and there are benefits to have tall buildings in Malta, where are we going to put them? So obviously, we have Porto Mazo, which is in Pacheville, and we have all these other potential tall buildings, some of them being constructed, some of them getting planning. But they're all centered around the Slema Pacheville St. Julian's area. And this is shown in this image from the Times of Malta. What I think that the Times of Malta image missed is actually where we are today, which is Valletta. Okay, it's outside where all the tall buildings are. And really and truly, I think we cannot ignore Valletta and the three cities across the harbor as well. But let's stick with Valletta for today. So Valletta, okay, it's a unique city. It's a World Heritage Site, and it defines basically the urban skyline of Malta, okay? It's a postcard, it's a perfect postcard picture. What about the skyline of Valletta and tall buildings around it, okay, with Slema just a couple of hundred meters away? And again, I'm going to refer back to what happens in London. So the concept of London, which Dimitri alluded to earlier, is this concept of view corridors. Okay, so there are specific points in London, typically parks, high grounds, etc., where the view of St. Paul's Cathedral has to be respected. Okay, so if you go to, say, Greenwich Park or Richmond Park down on the southwest, you should be able to see St. Paul's Cathedral in the distance. Okay, you cannot build anything to block that view. And this has defined, you know, where tall buildings could be. and how they are formed. So leading whole building there from Richard Rogers, the cheese grater, has a tilt just to miss the dome of St. Paul's when viewed down Fleet Street. Okay, it's not a coincidence, it's just there to respect, to give it space to St. Paul's Cathedral. And then Jean Nouvel took this view corridor concept a bit too literally, and he created a corridor in his One New Change building. But again, it created some interest, some visual interest, some photo opportunities, okay? We architects and designers always like photos of buildings and stuff. So it's not a bad idea. So going back to Valletta now, what about the skyline of Valletta? Okay, what are the vantage points where the skyline of Valletta should be respected? Which part of Valletta should be respected? Is it the dome? Is it the spire? Is it both of them? Is it all of Valletta? Okay. And obviously, with all respect to St. Paul's Cathedral, is St. Paul's Cathedral worthy more than what we call a city built by gentlemen for gentlemen? Okay. So, if we cannot just put buildings randomly, where are we going to put them? Okay, we obviously need some rules, okay? Call them rules, guidelines, whatever you want. Urban planners call it a master plan. Okay, so we need some sort of master plan, which was started a couple of years ago, which was a very good start, I would say. But we need one for the entire country, okay? Because Malta is the size of a large city abroad, I would say. So I'm going to refer to another case study from SON. So the London docks towards the east closed down in the 80s, okay, when there was no economic viability anymore, and this became industrial wasteland, essentially. So what happened then? There was this prime land waiting there, okay, and obviously the best solution would be to go up to create as much as possible, space as much as possible, from what was industrial wasteland. So SOM did a master plan, okay, for this whole district, which we now call Kenner Wharf, but it was called the Docklands in the 80s. And this was what SOM came up with, okay? So it did not design specifically the buildings as such. It did not say this building is, you know, this high and it has this sort of appearance and whatever. It just set the ground rules, okay? So all the buildings, the volumetric relationships between them, so we can see that all the buildings do not overshadow each other. There is space between buildings. There is open space between buildings. Another important thing, there is transportation to these buildings, okay? If you're building 30, 40 floors, okay, with 1,000 square meters each floor, you're talking about thousands of people. How to get these people there? So that is the first point. So what happened is, you start building your transport connections. You have to get people there, so you get a quick and easy solution, an exposed viaduct, which has a small capacity, but it's enough for the first 10 years, 10, 15 years. And then you can start building your tall buildings, because you can actually bring people to them. And in the meantime, you start getting a bigger underground system, which is the Jubilee Line extension, which took another 10, 15 years to build, okay, which would then serve the complete tall building development. So we're talking about 20, 30, 50, maybe 100 years, it doesn't matter. And transportation is key, okay? So you get all these fantastic opportunities by architects such as Foster to create stations, and public spaces again in stations. So this, again, this concept of giving something back to the public, even in a simple train station, which is pure infrastructure, I would say. And it works, okay? It brings people there during the rush hour, and it takes them back home, unless there is a strike, because if there is a strike, then it's a nightmare. But this is what happens if there is no public transport, okay? You get a nightmare. So going back to Malta now. If we have the tall buildings, if we have the benefits clearly defined, if we know that there is a master plan to set them, or where they should be, how to actually design them individually now, okay? So this is not the task of the designer, of the urban planner, this is the task of the designer. So I mentioned at the beginning this thing of the churches. So for many years, these were Malta's tallest buildings, and probably they are taller than some of the tallest buildings in Malta right now. And for many years, every town and village and city has been defined by the church, okay? So there's a story of when I was 4 years old, my father used to say, I used to know that we are at Birgu because I see the church of Birgu, or Sengle, or Zeytun in the background, or Mdina, or Cittadella, or wherever. okay? Because it gives identity, it gave pride, and then obviously we want to build taller than the one next to us, but that's another story. But for many years, this was the defining urban landscape of Malta, okay? The proportions of the church spire. So tall buildings, in a way, at least the way I see it, or a suggestion, would be, why not have a contemporary interpretation of this concept and continue it, okay? So we continue what was for almost 2,000 years, okay, since Christianity came around, until the next 2,000 years, possibly. And I'm going to refer again to Porto Mazo, okay? So in Porto Mazo, at least the way I see it, it is an interpretation of the church spire, okay? You can see the base, you can see the pilasters in the corners, you can see the telecoms tower, which is the cross on the dome, on the lantern. And the other thing would be the materials. So my first mentor, Ray Domicoli here, has a very nice story about Porto Mazo. So the client wanted to clad it with granite, because granite is luxurious, is expensive, it's nice, okay? But Ray said, granite in Malta? Okay, we don't even have volcanoes here. So he kept postponing, you know, this procurement process until he saw a project with terracotta tiles, and he found out from Piano's office what is the actual product, and in a few weeks' time it was there, okay? And you would agree with me that terracotta has a better connection with Malta than granite, unless you're doing your kitchen top. So I talked about Piano, okay? It doesn't have to be terracotta. So I'm not saying all tall buildings in Malta suddenly have to be like Porto Mazo with terracotta tiles, no. Piano, okay? Took the Maltese stone, which is Malta's made of Malta. Malta's made of Malta stone, okay? He took the very material which defines our landscape and just transformed it in a 21st century way, okay? A material which has been around for 5,000 years in a 21st century interpretation. Amazing. Many other architects have done this, okay? So it's not about just the material, it's even the form, the concept, okay? Richard England's Manikata Church, it's the Girna reinvented. The introvert farmhouse in Malta, which has inspired Simon Grex and Andrew Vinci's Villa Elena, and Chris Briffa's interpretation of the Galleria, okay? It's a reinvention of the Galleria, but again, I'm not saying that tall buildings should have Gallerias, eh? I mean, this is just how the past can inspire the present and the future, okay? We cannot just forget about our past. So this is how buildings should be designed. And then, what to actually fill with these buildings? Should they be apartments, offices, both? Planning, normally, at least in the UK, specifies very strictly, I would say, the mix, okay? Whether it's 1, 2, 3 bed, and how many of these apartments should be affordable housing. Obviously, in London, affordable is not affordable, but let's forget about that. So, is the planning authority, which kindly sponsored us tonight, stipulating a certain amount of affordable housing units in a project? And what is affordable, okay? Because in the last 20, 30 years, the prices went from 200 to 2,000 euros a square meter. So it's a huge, huge increase in cost. And we know that even until last week, Malta topped the global house price index. So everything is on the increase. And then transport, okay? I already mentioned about mass transportation, which is something we had 100 years ago, which we lost in time. But the other thing is, when it comes to design, we always have in our DC 2015, the minimum amount of parking spaces in a project, right? You know, you all have this nightmare of working out and then you have to pay more if you don't meet it. In the UK, there is a maximum number of spaces. If you put more spaces, you get penalized. It's completely the other way around, okay? What is this? This is discouraging car use, and this is what we need. We need to discourage car use. So not creating more parking spaces, but less. There is the issue of fire. Okay, we had a few fires recently. The Grenfell one in London was just a big tragedy, and the industry in the world hopefully learned something from it. So is the fire brigade ready to go up 20, 30, 40 floors? Do we have enough fire engines capacity? Are they trained to go up that high? Can we still have this typical apartment layout with a core leading into the apartments without any lobby, without any fire lifts, without any double doors leading onto stair escapes? Okay, so this cannot be just used in a tall building. Okay, this normal apartment layout we have been doing for many years, we cannot just extrapolate it to a tall building. And then there is a collapse. Okay, and just by doing a simple Google search, I saw that in the last 10 years there were almost 10 collapses, whether during construction or excavation or even in service. Okay, and one of them, even a wind, just a strong wind, collapsed an entire wall in a school. So we really need to follow some of these rules and take the engineering part a bit more seriously, I would say. And seismic. Okay, again, we're not Japan or California, but we do get earthquakes. Okay, and with the sort of highs we're looking at, where wind might not control, seismic might control. So we need to somehow incorporate this in our design. So if the planning authority is checking the architecture, the planning, the design itself, who is checking the engineering? Okay, because we are both. Is it the BRO? Is it a new body? Is it a merger of the two? Is it a new entity? Okay, such as the building control in the UK, which is very disorganized, I must say, but I guess imperfect is better than inexistent. So the other thing, how they should be built. Okay, so we have looked at whether we need them, what are the benefits, where to put them, how to design them, now how to build them. So the building process in Malta has always been an evolution, okay? So we started with the very sort of vernacular, one, two-story farmhouse, just normal load-bearing masonry, undressed stone. Then we moved to the two-story sort of townhouse, no? So again, load-bearing walls, and then three, four-story palazzos here in Valletta. And masonry was serving us right for many, many years. And then we started to experiment with steel beams, you know, the I-beams we see in townhouses. And then concrete came into the picture. But we cannot just extrapolate this for a 30, 40 foot story building, okay? There has to be a sort of shift in the way we think. So what I would suggest at this point is how to design tall buildings. Challenge the status quo, okay? We cannot just say, because we have done it like this for 2,000 years or 5,000 years, okay? This is a completely different animal. You cannot accept imma dikalfej perit. We cannot just accept these sort of attitudes from contractors, okay? Challenge them. Challenge them as designers. We cannot have load-bearing walls. It just doesn't make sense, okay? If you're building your own house, fine. You're not affecting anyone else. But if you have many other people on top of you, if you remove your wall, then it becomes a nightmare, okay? So we cannot have load-bearing walls in tall buildings. Just use lightweight partitions, which everyone can move around or not have them at all. And they are less heavy, okay, so it's less impact on the structure. Same goes with all this screed or torba, you know, which is extremely heavy. It's heavier than a room full of overweight people. Okay, just get off with this torba idea. Just have a raised floor, put your services there, accessible, clean, light. What's the other thing? The facades, okay? So we cannot, okay, masonry is amazing, okay? It served us well, it defines our fabric. Piano used it well. But if we're going to use it, we cannot use it like building a normal house, okay? We cannot have facades built with cannot enter this anymore, okay? We should go for modern systems which have insulation in them, which have modularity, unitized systems, whether they're glass or even stone with a stone facing, whatever. But we cannot take 10, 15 years to build a building, okay? The Empire State Building was built in a year, and that's 103 floors. And that was built 100 years ago. And then health and safety, dust, noise. We just have to catch up, okay? We have to move on to the 21st century. So just to conclude now, I think tall buildings are amazing, okay? It's a good opportunity for everyone. And there are challenges, there are technical challenges which we engineers like to solve. There are obviously financial challenges, so you need the right people. But you need a good team. You need a good urban design team, you need a good architectural team, and you need good engineers who have done it before, who know how to do it, okay? You can get it wrong in a low rise, maybe in a medium rise, but certainly not in a tall building, okay? You can't get it wrong. So you need an integrated approach, okay? So that's the planners, the architects, the engineers, the politicians, and politicians, not party politicians, it's the people who actually set up these rules, okay? Because we designers cannot make up the rules. We can inform them, but someone else has to make them. Then we as designers do something intelligent with these rules, okay? And create these tall buildings. So I'll leave with this quote from Virilio. So when the ship was invented many years ago, this meant also that shipwrecks could happen, okay? So things can go wrong. But doesn't mean that all ships shipwreck. If they are built properly and designed properly, they'll be fine. And this is the same thing we have to do with tall buildings. Okay? If they are designed with the right attitude, with the right skill set, with the right mindset, then what you are building today will basically, in a few years' time, and that could be 100 or 200 years' time, they will be alongside Medina and Valletta, and they will basically define what we call Product Malta. Thank you, everyone.